स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग. वेलकम बैक टू आवर साइंस क्लास ऑफ क्लास 8. दिस इज़ चैप्टर 9, सेकेंड पार्ट. फर्स्ट पार्ट आई हैव ऑलरेडी टॉट यू, एंड इन दिस सेकेंड पार्ट वी आर गोइंग टू कवर द सर्टन टॉपिक्स. सो द टॉपिक्स दैट वी आर गोइंग टू कवर टूडे आर इन विच द फर्स्ट टॉपिक इज मेल रिप्रोडक्टिव सिस्टम. Now today we are going to know about the male reproductive system. In our previous part, I have told you about the female reproductive system, about the reproduction. I have told you that what is reproduction, what are the two types of reproduction. So what is fertilization? So today we are going to cover these topics, in which the first one is male reproductive system. So let's know about what is male reproductive system. As the human male reproductive system is consists of following parts. There is one diagram is given to you. In that diagram, just look at here. These organs are testes, scrotal sacs, epididymis, sperm ducts, seminal vesicles and penis. So these are the reproductive organs of the male. Human male reproductive system, as shown to you here, since the male is called a man, so we can also say that it is the reproductive system of man. Testes are oval shaped organs which lie outside the abdominal cavity of a man. Just look at the diagram here. There's a testes, pair of testes is there, and its shape is oval and which lies outside the abdominal cavity of a man. Man has two testes. Testes are the real reproductive organs in man. Male sex cells or male gametes, or we can say sperms, are made in testes. So where the testes, where the sperm formation takes place, it takes place in the testes. Testes make male gametes called sperm. So the male gametes formation takes place in the testes. Millions of sperms are produced in the testes. Testes are enclosed in two small bags of skin called scrotal sacs, and it is enclosed in two small bags of skin that is commonly known as scrotal sacs. The testes works more efficiently at a temperature slightly below the body temperature, so they are held outside the body of the scrotal sacs. The sperms found in testes come out and go into the coiled tube. There is a coiled tube, and that coiled tube is known as epididymis. Look at the diagram. In the diagram it is given to you. There is a coiled tube, and that coiled tube is known as epididymis. The sperms get stored temporarily in epididymis, and from epididymis the sperms are carried by a long tube, that tube is known as sperm duct, into the organs called seminal vesicles. So after that, the sperms are carried by a long tube from the epididymis. The sperms are carried by a long tube, and that long tube is known as sperm duct, and from the sperm duct it goes into the organs that is known as seminal vesicles. The sperm gets stored in seminal vesicles, and there the sperms get stored. The seminal vesicles joined to another tube called urethra coming from the bladder. Urethra carries the sperms to an organ called penis, which open outside the body. These sperms are carried in a liquid, and that liquid is called semen. The penis is an organ for introducing the sperms into the woman. Penis passes the sperm from the man's body to the woman's body for the purpose of reproduction. The male reproductive system is designed to manufacture the sperms and to deliver them to place where one of them will be able to fuse with the egg of the female gamete and bring about the fertilization. So this is about the male reproductive system. I have told you about that. Now the next topic is fertilization. So the fertilization, that's I have already told you that what is fertilization. I have told you that the fusion of male and female gamete is known as fertilization. And where it takes place? It takes place inside the female body. Where it takes place? It takes place in the oviduct or fallopian tube. So again, I am going to tell you about this. The fertilization. In fertilization, the sperms are made in the testes of the male, are introduced by the penis into the woman's body through the vagina. The sperms enters into the vagina and passes through the uterus and then goes into the oviducts. The tail of the sperms help in moving and to reach the oviducts. If at the same time the ovary of the woman releases an egg or woman or egg or we can say ovum, this egg also goes into the oviduct and one of the sperms enters the egg, and the fusion of the sperm with the egg is known as fertilization takes place. During fertilization, the nucleus of the sperm fuses with the nucleus of the egg to form a single nucleus, and this result in the formation of a fertilized egg, and that fertilized egg is called zygote. Thus, the sperm combines with the egg in the oviduct and fertilizes to form a zygote. The zygote, or we can say the fertilized egg, is the beginning of the formation of a new baby, or we can say a new individual. So by this way the fertilization takes place. So I have told you that how the fertilization takes place in the oviduct. Now the next topic is about the development of embryo. Now we are going to know that how the development of the embryo takes place. As we know that the division in the zygote takes place, it divides repeatedly to make a ball of 100 of cells, and this is called an embryo. So how you can define the embryo? The zygote undergoes the division to make the ball of 100 of cells, and this is known as embryo. Embryo moves down the oviduct into the uterus, and then after this embryo moves down the oviduct and enters into the uterus, the embryo gets embedded in soft and thick lining of the uterus, and this is known as implantation. So the embedding of the embryo into the thick and soft lining of the uterus is commonly known as implantation. So when the embryo gets settled down in the uterus, the woman is said to have become pregnant and or said to have conceived. The embryo starts growing into a baby. The embryo gets food and oxygen from the blood vessels in the lining of the uterus. From where it gets the food and oxygen? It gets the food and oxygen mainly from the blood vessels in the lining of the uterus. The cells in the embryo begin to form a specialized group and then develop into the different tissues and organs of the baby. Embryo is an early stage in the developing baby. The question may be asked that which is known as the early stage in the developing baby. The answer is embryo. Embryo is the early stage in a developing baby. Thus, an unborn baby at the early stage of development in the uterus is known as embryo. And we can define it like this also. The unborn baby at the early stage of development in the uterus is called an embryo. The body features of the unborn baby are not much developed at the embryo stage. The unborn baby remains an embryo in the first 8 weeks of pregnancy. A human embryo at 4 to 5 weeks development takes place. We cannot identify any body features like hands, legs, head, eyes and ears of the developing baby in the embryo. That embryo continues to grow and develop in the uterus to form a baby. The embryo gradually develops the body parts such as hands, legs, head and eyes and ears. The unborn baby in the uterus at this stage, when its all body parts can be identified, is known as fetus. So this stage is known as fetus stage. When the unborn baby in the uterus at the stage when its all the parts can be identified, it is known as fetus. So the word fetus is pronounced as fetus. A human body embryo becomes a fetus after about 8 weeks of pregnancy, and from about 8 weeks until the birth, unborn baby is called fetus, and it takes about 38 weeks or about 9 months from the fertilization of the egg to the formation of fully developed baby. And when the development of fetus into the baby is complete, the mother gives birth to the baby. The fully formed baby comes out from the mother's body through the vagina, and we say that the baby is born. This is how the human reproduce by giving birth to babies. So this is about the development of the embryo. Now, viviparous and oviparous animals. Now we are going to know that which kind of animals are known as viviparous animals and which kind of animals are known as oviparous animals. Some animals that give birth to the young ones. The animals that give birth to the young ones are known as viviparous animals. Vivi means alive and parous means bearing. In viviparous animals, the young one develops in the uterus inside the body of the mother, and when the young one is fully developed, then the mother gives birth to which the alive young one comes out from the body of the mother. The viviparous animals do not lay eggs outside their body like birds and reptiles do. In case of viviparous animals, the mother or the female parent give birth to a fully developed baby animal called young one. For example, in human beings, the mother gives birth to a baby, so the humans are viviparous animals. Some other example of viviparous animals are cow, dog, cat, lion, tiger, horse, rabbit, rat, elephant, camel. So all the mammals are called the viviparous animals. Now we are going to know about that which kind of animals are known as oviparous animals. Those animals which lay eggs from which the young ones are hatched later on are called oviparous animals. Ovi means relating to eggs and parous means bearing. So in case of oviparous animals, the mother or the female parent lay the eggs outside its body. The young one of the animal develops inside the egg, and when the development of the young one inside the egg is complete, the eggshell breaks open and a live young one baby animals comes out of it, and this is called hatching. For example, when the hen lays eggs, the young one of the hen or chick develops inside the egg. When the development of the chick inside the hen's egg is complete, the egg shell breaks open and a live chick comes out of it. Since a hen eggs from which its young ones chicks are hatched, therefore the hen is an oviparous animal. Some other example of oviparous animals are sparrow, cow, butterfly, housefly, frog, fish, lizard, snake, ostrich, crocodile. So these are the examples of the some other oviparous animals. So this is about the oviparous animals and the viviparous animals. So the viviparous animals are those animals which give birth to the young ones, and oviparous animals are those animals which lay the eggs from which the young ones are hatched later on. Now, our next topic is about, so this is a picture that is given to you in which there are the pictures of the certain animals, and there are some animals which comes in the category of oviparous animals that lays the egg and that hatch, and viviparous animals that give birth to the young ones. So next topic is about the metamorphosis. Now we are going to know about that what is this metamorphosis process. As we know that the number of animals such as birds, frogs, insects are hatched from the eggs. For example, the chicks are hatched from the eggs of the hen. Similarly, the frogs and silk moths are also hatched from their eggs. Now, when a chick comes out of the egg of a hen, its overall appearance is almost same as that of adult hen, except that it is much smaller than the hen. So, when a small chick grows and develops to become an adult hen, or cock, there is not much change in its body appearance. That is, the young one of the hen chick hatched from the egg and the adult hen look alike. But this is not so in case of animals such as frogs and silk moths. For example, the young ones, larva or tadpole in frogs hatched from the eggs look very different from the adult frog. So the larva or the tadpole of the frog, that are the young ones of the frogs that is hatched from the eggs, are not look similar to the adult frogs. They look very different from the adult frog. The process of transformation from an immature form of an animal like larva is what it is, an immature form, to its adult form in two or more distinct stages is known as metamorphosis. So this process of transformation of immature form of an animal, that immature form that is larva, to its adult form in two or more distinct stage is commonly known as metamorphosis. So in simple words, we can say that the change of the larva to an adult animal is commonly known as metamorphosis. We can also define it like this: the change of a larva to an adult animal is commonly known as metamorphosis. Metamorphosis occurs in amphibians like frogs, insects such as silk moth, butterfly, housefly, mosquito. So in all these kinds of insects and animals, metamorphosis process takes place. Now I am going to give you an example of metamorphosis in frog. So there is one diagram is given to you that shows how the metamorphosis occurs in frog. So I am going to tell you about this. The hatching of fertilized egg of frog produces a very immature young one called tadpole, or we can say larva. Tadpole or larva are the same thing. Don't be confused in these two. The tadpole or larva of frog develops gradually and undergoes many drastic changes in appearance before it forms an adult frog. The tadpole looks very different from the adult frog. We say that during its life cycle, a frog undergoes metamorphosis. The transformation of larva into an adult through the drastic changes in its appearance is commonly known as metamorphosis. The change from the tadpole to the frog is an example of metamorphosis that can be represented to you here in the form of diagram. So this given diagram shows you the metamorphosis that changes the tadpole into a frog. So the diagram that is given to you shows that how the tadpole of the frog undergoes the drastic changes and it gets converted into adult frog. So this process shows the metamorphosis, how the metamorphosis takes place in case of frog. So this is about the metamorphosis that I have told you. Like that of the other example that we can take of metamorphosis in silk moth. Now I am going to tell you about how the metamorphosis takes place in silk moth. Silk moth is an insect like butterfly which undergoes metamorphosis during its life cycle. The silk moth passes through the larva and pupa stage during its development after hatching from the egg and forms an adult silk moth. So the eggs are hatched, it gets converted into caterpillar or larva, and that caterpillar larva, or we can say larva, undergoes a metamorphosis and gets converted into pupa, and that pupa further undergoes a metamorphosis and then finally converted into adult silk moth. So the changes during the formation of an adult from the silk from an adult silk moth from its egg, I have told you about this. So there is a point to note that the caterpillar, or we can say the larva and the pupal stages in the development, look very different from the adult silk moth. There have been drastic changes in its appearance during the transformation of caterpillar into the adult silk moth. Thus, the change from the caterpillar to a silk moth is an example of metamorphosis. So, this is the second example that I have told you. Firstly, I have told you about the metamorphosis in case of frog, and this is about the metamorphosis in case of silk moth. Now, I'm going to tell you about the asexual reproduction. In our previous part, in our first part of this chapter, I have told you about the sexual reproduction. I have told that in case of sexual reproduction, the two parents are involved and there is involvement of the gametes, male gamete and female gamete. So here we are going to know about that, how the asexual reproduction takes place. So asexual reproduction is a type of reproduction. We can say that in this reproduction only one parent is required. There is no requirement of two parents. There is no requirement of both male and female parent. One parent is able to form able to produce a new ones. So, and there is no any involvement of gametes, male gamete and female gametes. There is no need of gametes here. So we are going to know more about the asexual reproduction, and we are going to know that what are the different methods of the asexual reproduction in organism. So asexual reproduction, we can define it like this. Asexual reproduction is the production of new organism from a single parent without the involvement of sex cells or gametes. New organism produced by the asexual reproduction is exactly identical to the parent. So that a new organism that arises here from the parent is exactly similar to the parent. And there are two common methods of asexual reproduction in animals. That two common method in which the first one is binary fission and the second one is budding. So I'm going to tell about these two process, what is binary fission and what is budding. Now here in the process of fission, the parent organism divides to form the two or more new organism. Fission begins with the division of the nucleus, and it is followed by the division of the cytoplasm to form a new organism. So in case of binary fission, firstly there is a division of nucleus, and that is followed by the division of the cytoplasm to form a new organism. So in case of binary fission, the parent organism splits, or we can say it divides, to form two or more new organism. Fission is of two types, binary fission and multiple fission. Depending on whether the parent organism splits to form new organism or more than two organism. When the one parent organism gets splits to form two new organism, it is known as binary fission. And when one parent organism splits to form more than two new organism, it is known as multiple fission. So firstly, we are going to know about the binary fission process. So here there is one diagram that is given to you that shows the different methods of the asexual reproduction. The first one is the binary fission in amoeba. The second diagram given to you shows that it is the budding in hydra. And the third one shows that budding in yeast. So these are the common methods of the binary fission. I'm going to tell you about the binary fission. Binary fission is an asexual method of reproduction in an organism. In case of binary fission, the parent organism splits or divides to form two new organisms. Look at the diagram here. Binary fission in first diagram that shows the binary fission in amoeba, in which the one parent amoeba gets split to form two parts. This happens as follows. When the amoeba cells has reached its maximum size of growth, then first the nucleus of the amoeba gets increased in its length and gets divided into two parts. After that, the cytoplasm of the amoeba divided into two parts, one part around each nucleus. And in this way, one parent amoeba divides to form two smaller amoebae
or we can say daughter amoeba, and we say that one amoeba produces two amoeba, and the reproduction in amoeba by the binary fission is shown to you in the given diagram. So the first diagram shows the binary fission, how the binary fission takes place in amoeba. Amoeba takes about 1 hour to divide into two daughter amoeba. The two daughter amoeba produced here to grow the full size by eating the food and then divide again to produce four amoeba and so on. The daughter amoeba produced by this process of binary fission are identical to the parent amoeba. So this is about the binary fission in amoeba that I have told you. Another example of the unicellular animal like paramecium. Paramecium also reproduces by the asexual method of binary fission. And there are some examples that we can take. We can also take the example of budding. Budding is also the asexual method of reproduction. So here the buds here means a small outgrowth from the body. The second diagram is given to you that shows the budding in Hydra. So firstly we define that what is bud. Bud is a small outgrowth from the body of a parent. Bud is formed on the body of an organism, then the nucleus divides into two and one of the nuclei passes into the bud. Now about the budding, I am going to tell you more about the budding process. Budding is an asexual method of reproduction. In budding, a small part of the body of the parent organism grows out as a bud, which deattached and become new organism. Asexual reproduction by budding is observed in animals, mainly Hydra and sponges and corals. So here what happens, Hydra is a simple multicellular animal. Hydra reproduces by the process of budding. In Hydra, a small outgrowth is commonly known as bud, is formed on the side of its body. Look at the diagram. By repeated division of its cell, this bud grows gradually to form a small hydra by developing a mouth and tentacles. And finally, a tiny new hydra deattached itself from the body of the parent hydra and leaves a separate organism. In this way, the parent hydra has produced or created a new hydra. The hydra reproduces asexually by growing buds from its body, and this process is known as budding. The bud formed in a hydra is not a single cell, it is a group of cells. If we collect some pond water and observe it through a hand magnifying glass, we will see the number of hydrae with small buds attached to their body. Now, we conclude that in the tiny animals like Hydra, new hydrae develop from the buds. This is the method of asexual reproduction in Hydra, and this is known as budding. Apart from the binary fission budding, there are some other methods of asexual reproduction by which a single parent produces young ones. So this is about the asexual reproduction that occurs in case of amoeba, in case of Hydra. Like the third example is the third diagram is given to you that shows the budding in yeast. Yeast is a kind of unicellular organism, and in case of Hydra, the budding takes place. In case of yeast also, this asexual method of reproduction that is commonly known as budding takes place in yeast also. So this is the examples of the asexual reproduction. Now we are going to know about the test tube baby. Now let's know about that, why this kind of baby is known as test tube baby. So here, as we know that where the fertilization takes place in female. In female, the fertilization takes place in the oviduct. I have told you. In some cases, what happens? The oviduct of the woman gets blocked due to certain reasons, and that's why they are not able to bear the babies. So in this case, a type of fertilization is done, and that type of fertilization is known as IVF. I stands for in vitro fertilization. The full form of IVF is in vitro fertilization, and in this type of fertilization, the freshly released egg and the sperms are kept together. They are kept together. The freshly released egg is taken out from the female body, and the sperms are taken out from the male body, and they are kept together for a few hours, and this allowed the formation of the zygote. And about 1 week, there is a formation of zygote. And when the zygote formation takes place, that zygote gets placed into the mother uterus, and the baby is born. In this technique, this technique is commonly known as test tube babies. So this is about the test tube baby that I have told you, that how the test tube baby develops. So I'm going to tell you about the implantation also. Implantation means the close attachment of the embryo with the walls of the uterus. Now how the embryo gets the food and the nutrition from the mother body. So there is a close attachment of the embryo with the walls of the uterus, and this close attachment of the embryo with the walls of the uterus is commonly known as implantation. So this is about the implantation. Now students, today I have covered all the topics that is given in this chapter. I have told you about all the things that is given in this chapter. And this is the last topic that I have told you. I have told you about the in vitro fertilization also. So, in in vitro fertilization, so there is a question that sometimes asked that how this in vitro fertilization technique helps a woman with blocked oviducts in having babies. So, I am going to tell you about that. The eggs, firstly what happens in case of in vitro fertilization, the eggs are removed from the ovary of the woman by laparoscopy, and in this operation there is a small cut made in the side of the woman's abdomen, and an optical fiber tube is inserted into her body so that the doctor can see the ovary and take out the tiny eggs. The woman's husband provides the sperm in the form of semen. The sperms are mixed with the eggs in a glass disc, or we can say glass test tube, to carry out the fertilization. The fertilized eggs, after the fertilization, there is a formation of fertilized egg. I have already told you that is known as zygote. So the zygote develops, and then the zygote undergoes further division and gets converted into embryo. In about a week, or one or more embryo are placed in the woman uterus, and if the embryo gets implanted in the uterus successfully, then a normal pregnancy occurs and baby born after about 9 months. In vitro fertilization technique is used to help those couples in having the babies who cannot produce the sperms and eggs, but the fertilization cannot take place inside the woman body due to the blocked oviducts or blocked fallopian tube. The in vitro fertilization technique was initially developed for carrying out the reproduction in farm animals like cows and buffaloes in 1950. This technique was used successfully for the reproduction of animals in 1978. A large number of babies are now born in our country by using in vitro fertilization technique. The success rate of this technique was only about 30-40%. The babies born through the in vitro fertilization technique are also known as test tube babies, because the fertilization takes place in the glass test tube. This is, however, a wrong name, but except for a few brief period of about 1 week of fertilization and very early development, which is spent in a test tube, almost the entire growth and development of the baby takes place inside the uterus of the woman as normal pregnancy. So this is about the in vitro fertilization I have told you. So I have covered all the topics that is given in this chapter. So students, complete your mock work as soon as possible, and we are going to provide the question, we are going to provide the answers of the questions that is given in the book, and try to solve the exercises that is given in this chapter yourself. So students, do your studies well. Thank you.